This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we're going to have something I've wanted to do for a long time. We have many times on this show, in many, many ways, over many, many years, explored the feminine side of Wicca and witchcraft. But it has a masculine side too. We've only been there once in the whole history of Dreamland, and now we're going there a second time, because this is also a rich, rich history. And it's the right time of year, because we have Halloween, Samhain, all of these festivals happening at this particular point in the year. And so we're going to honor that on the show. I have often produced scary shows, and I read one of my horror stories for subscribers one year and got about 6 responses. So I think I'm going to try a little something different this time. And to do that, I would like to introduce you to a really remarkable and remarkably talented man called Darragh Mason. And I'm not sure I did that right. I think it's Darragh Mason. Darragh, can you get us clued into your name before we even start?
You got it right. Yeah, Darragh Mason.
Darragh Mason. His website is darraghmason.com. And on there, you will discover that he is an extremely talented man. I mean, to say the least, he is a brilliant photographer, award-winning. He is English and living in a lovely area called town called Hastings.
Irish, actually, but I do live in England, but I'm from Ireland.
All right, well, please don't fly Christmas, because
not
they might
all,
work.
Not at all.
They might work in your case. Yes, I've just. That is not the worst insult possible for an Irishman, but it's certainly in that direction. Anyway, he has beautiful photography on his website. Don't miss it, darraghmason.com. But we're going to be talking about something very different today. We're going to be talking about his new book, Song of the Dark Man, Father of Witches, Lord of the Crossroads. What an extraordinary story to Darragh, and thank you for contributing this to the literature, because the dark man is dark, and that's why most of us know nothing whatsoever about him. But it's time to change that. All right, let me see how to ease into this. Okay, in Mark Adams's introduction, he talks about the dark man and his place in the witch's Sabbath. And I think maybe the best place for us to start is to go back beyond that a little bit to you. At some point in your life, you weren't interested in this.
Sure.
Then you were. What happened?
It's a great place to start. But before I get into that, I just want to say what an honor it is to be on your show, Whitley. I've been a follower, a reader, and a fan of yours for many years. So it really is an honor to be here. I guess where it started for me was... in the folklore. I spent many years looking at the folklore of the jinn from the Islamic and Arabic world. And that brought me back to Ireland, looking at the fairy folklore and the folklore of Britain and Ireland more broadly. And what I started to notice was this dark figure would turn up in the folklore, sometimes as the king of the fairies, sometimes as the folkloric devil, or sometimes a kind of anomalous lord of the dead. And it was striking enough that I was able to find more and more about this figure. And I did research into the Irish school's folkloric collection, which it could be found on the website ducas.ie. And what it is it's a collection of folklore gathered from the schools of Ireland in the mid to early part of the last century. And I found more. And I found the Irish name for this figure, which is Anfar Durka, meaning the dark man in Gaelic. And as I was doing this research, I started my own podcast called Spirit Box about 4.5 years ago. And the goal of Spirit Box was to interview people who had a background in magic or had experienced the other in the form of spirits, and to kind of explore folklore further. And when I started to interview magicians and witches, this figure came up again and again as an initiator. As when people explained why they moved into witchcraft or magic, this figure would come up repeatedly. Not consistently, but he was there. This dark man or the man in black would appear in dreams or manifest in people's lives. And it was a call to initiation for some. And that was that's what brought it forward for me. I started to see the same passion occur in the folklore has occurred in the passions of these contemporary witches.
A call to initiation. This is one of the fundamental realities of human life and of the modern world, even though we tell ourselves, well, we're past all that now, that we're not, the spirit world is a myth. It doesn't exist. We stop here,
yeah,
not out there. This is our new modern myth, and it's as much a myth, maybe it's much more of a myth. The question is, where do you find him in yourself? Because he's in there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, before we go any deeper, we're going to take a brief break for our free Dreamlanders, and I thank you so much for being with us. Please stay on after the commercials. They won't last long, and they might interest you. We'll be right back. I am working on the first book to go into any reliable and accurate detail about the visitors' bodies, what they are like, how they function, and also how they relate to us, how their perceptual system works in comparison to ours, and what the disconnect is, because there's a major disconnect here. If there wasn't a disconnect, disclosure would have happened 50 years ago. There's a disconnect. The book is about fixing that disconnect. It'll be out as soon as I get it finished, before Christmas, I'm sure. If you've got any questions about the show, questions about anything, my weird life or your weird life, anything like that, DM me the questions. I'm here. I'm not far away. And so I will respond. We're talking to Darragh Mason. His website, darraghmason.com. His new book, Song of the Dark Man, Father of Witches, Lord of the Crossroads. I find it all so incredibly poetic and beautiful in a way. And yet, there's this, he's not called the Light Man.
Yes, you're absolutely right. Yeah, he's called many things. This is part of the mystery. You know, it seems to be a living archetype with a magical current, we would say, in occult circles, that he has many names, many faces, and perhaps no true name and no true face. But when you ask the question, where would we find him? We find him in our songs. We find him in our art. We find him in our poetry. As much as he is the initiator into witchcraft, he's also a driving force, in my opinion, behind creativity. And this is why the book is called Song of the Dark Man, because it leans into the element of inspiration where people are driven to create, you know. And I talk at the start of the book that this is an inspirational and disruptive force. And we find this theme both within Arabic lore, with the jinn, who are said to inspire poetry. And we find it within British and Irish lore with the fairies, who are said to inspire music. All the best pipers were said to be inspired by the fairies or taken to fairyland where they were given their songs and airs. And I think the creative force is something similar. And Jung spoke to it to a degree when he spoke about being in the grip of the daemon, one's personal daemon that drove one forward to complete a task, whatever that might be. And, you know, that's not an easy thing. I mean, Jung spoke about that being a challenging thing. He said, I had to obey an inner law which was imposed on me that left me with no freedom of choice. And similarly, we see with the dark man, it can be in that territory. You look at, say, some of the great musicians of our age, where we have, you know, I guess the most famous of all account is Robert Johnson, the great blues guitarist, who was said to have gone to the crossroads, where he mediated with the dark man who tuned his guitar and handed it back to him. And when he took it back, he had wonderful musical talent, the ability to write fantastic songs, and wealth, women, and song. All this mythos is around Robert Johnson and his crossroads episode. But it doesn't stop there. There's an account of Bob Dylan in the early 2000s. He was on 60 Minutes, kind of the American magazine show.
Right, you know it well.
Yeah. He was asked, why are you still working? You know, what's compelling you to continue to work? And he replied, it goes back to a destiny thing. I made a bargain with it a long time ago. And he's holding up his end. And when he was pressed as to kind of, well, what or who exactly are you talking about? He said, with the chief commander of this earth and the world you can't see. And that description to any witch or would be, that's, he's talking about the dark man, the old master, the old one. So he can definitely be found in our art. There's no doubt about that to me. And that goes back into our stories. And that's kind of the premise of the book. I unpack some of the old mythology of Ireland and kind of demonstrate how this shadowy figure is the one pulling the strings that links the age of heroes to the age of Christianity and now to modernity. But the striking thing about all of this is what we hear in the folklore, what we read in the folklore, is mirrored almost exactly in the world of witchcraft and in modern day experience of witches, and in the historic experience of witches.
In modern day creative experiences, because what you're talking about with Bob Dylan, I mean, that happened, you know, that, and it's certainly in my case, it's the same. I'm sure it is in yours as well.
Yeah.
It was not the dark man in my case. It was definitely a woman. Yeah. But the inspiration was just as powerful. And I'm on that same path and I'll never get off it. I'll die with my boots on for sure. Let me see. Let's talk about fire in the blood. I think that's an important concept, and it's one that it fits right now in the conversation very well. What is this? What does this mean exactly?
So there's a concept within witchcraft known as witch blood, and essentially it's a phrase to try and encapsulate a difference that is within people who become witches. And essentially it can be a thing that might refer to lineage, of some description, family history, that kind of thing. But it can also be seemingly quite random that people can have that with the witch blood essentially turned on or activated within them. And that's kind of why I use the phrase fire in the blood, as it kind of separates from ideas of kind of just genealogy and family lines. And while I do think that exists, I think it's a broader concept. So the way I kind of describe it is it invokes the illuminative qualities of inspiration and received mysticism that the dark man can ignite within us, within our hearts. And I would say, like, a determining factor of having this fire in the blood is like a sensitivity or an ability to work with the other world, you know. And that doesn't mean proficiency. That doesn't mean people are necessarily good at it or understand what's happening. You know, and this is why it's almost universal that we have mystery schools or shamanic traditions around the world, where people who are demonstrating these capabilities kind of just with natural capability can get that, get those skills refined and trained so they can master them and be in more control of them rather than at the whim or behest of them, you know. And that's something that we see is it's really missing in the West, you know, to your point about kind of the Western headspace can often see there's nothing else beyond my tangible material experience.
We've buried ourselves alive in our own heads.
Yes, absolutely.
That's what we've done. Mm-hmm. And speaking of burials and disinterments, it's time to take another break, and I'll figure out later why that connection is makes sense, or perhaps I won't. In any case, Free Dreamlanders, we'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories, into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
We're talking to Darragh Mason about the dark man. His book is absolutely fascinating to me because it has a it goes into a part of witchcraft that has almost been buried. I've interviewed people on this show who believe that witchcraft belongs to the feminine and that the male side of it really doesn't belong there at all. And the, you know, radical, and I've been with even more radical witches who wouldn't do, interview on my show because I'm a man. And what is going on there in the craft itself? Because you seem to have a place in the craft. Mm-hmm.
It's hard to say. I mean, it depends on kind of where, you know, there's different types of witchcraft, you know, I think it depends on the type of coven or tradition that one is part of. It can vary hugely. You know, the royal spirit may be Hecate, you know, and in that sense it's very much a female line. But if you look through the history of say the witch trials within Britain, particularly Scotland, you know, you will see that the leader of the witch's Sabbath is the devil, it is a male figure, you know, and it will be described very much as modern witches would describe, you know, a being that is part human, that can appear any way it wants. It's a shapeshifter, a turnskin, can appear any way it wants, part human, fully human, may appear as a deer, you know, but it's a male figure. And again, these are not universal things. It's hugely strong female energy within witchcraft. There's no denying that. But this initiator is very much a male figure. And if I could just go back a little bit to the fire and the blood conversation we had earlier, one important factor in this is within Islamic, more broadly Arabic lore, and within Irish lore, you have the concept of people who have fairy or jinn heritage, that they're not entirely human, and this seems to be connected with fire and blood. It's a consistent thing.
Let me ask you this. You mentioned the Arabic and the Irish mythologies together a number of times. What is their connection? Is there some kind of connection along the lines that Graham Hancock, say, might advocate, that there were links between these cultures in the very, very deep past?
It's very hard to say, but I would imagine that there were definitely trade links. You know, I think where we have a lot of similarity is in the fact that kind of both countries or both areas of the world are dominated by Abrahamic faiths and within
Nowadays, they weren't all.
That's very true, and you're right to say so. I fundamentally think the link is there are two places that are experiencing the other through the cultural lens of their location in the world. So in essence, I would say in a very, very simplistic way that the jinn are Arabic fairies and the fairies are Irish jinn. You know, they exhibit extraordinarily similar qualities. That the crossovers are ridiculous. There's an association with hidden treasure. There's an association with ruined places. There's an association with the dead. There's an association with child theft, with changelings. Down to the things like the jinn are said to travel in the wind. Well, the fairies travel in the shi-giha, the fairy wind. They're also harbingers of death. And I read a really interesting detail that I found in an anthropological book about Cairo, and then similarly found a newspaper clipping from the Western People, which is a newspaper from home in the west of Ireland. And the book is called Living with Jinns by Dr. Barbara Dryskins, and she talks about a particular taboo from throwing dirty water out the front door when you kind of after you've cleaned your home, whatever, throwing the dirty water out the front door, that in Cairo you're supposed to say a kind of a bismillah to warn the unseen there that this is coming and to get out of the way and no harm is intended. And this woman didn't do that, and there was a black dog on the street. Now the black dog is associated with the jinn, It is also associated with the good people. And of course, you'll hear stories and in folkloric stories in England of like the Black Shuck, this monstrous black dog terrorizing the moors and the byways and highways. So it's that in itself is a symbol of these spirits, a manifestation of these spirits. Now, the woman was struck blind for doing this. And then afterwards, it took her many, many weeks to get her sight back, many trips to sheikhs to do praying and exorcisms, try and get her sight back. And as she got her sight back, all she could see was the appearance of this, the impression of this black dog in her field of vision until her vision finally returned. Now, interestingly, they talked in the Western people of the same taboo that people in their croft cottages in the west of Ireland would shout a warning in Gaelic before throwing dirty water from their homes, saying, look out, Ishka Solika chocked, dirty water is coming. And this one woman who didn't do it, and the legend says, is that her face was turned backwards overnight.
Backwards?
Yeah, around her head. So her features were on the back of her head. So we have almost like for like taboos. We have so many similarities here between the good people and the jinn, even down to the terminology that's used for them.
Maybe the connection isn't some kind of ancient seafaring at all, but the fact that the jinn and the good people are the same, and both the Arabs and the Irish are being taught by the same people.
I think that's a very strong proposition.
What an interesting thought. Gosh, I've never thought of that before. I've always seen these things as culturally isolated, and that any connection had to be kind of a physical one. But now I realize, no, what we're talking about is something very big here and very different.
Yeah.
That's fascinating. I'm going to have a lot of fun working with my head with this.
You know, and both these beings have you know, accounts of sexual interest in human beings.
Yeah, I've noticed that myself. Well, you know, you ought to write a second book, which would be about the relationship between the good people and the jinn.
Yeah, perhaps, yeah.
Oh, that would be fabulous. What an interesting idea. Now, I've got a whole list of questions here. Isabel Gowdy's Confessions and Shape-Shifting. Tell us a little bit about Isabel Gowdy and this whole remarkable area, folks. We're going to go down another path here that you're not expecting. So let's enjoy this and have fun. I'm going to take myself out of the picture and let Darren just do it. Darragh Mason, Song of the Dark Man, darraghmason.com.
So Isabel Gowdy was tried for witchcraft in 1662 in Scotland. In the town of Aldern, and he made four confessions over a 6-week period, and these are by far the most vivid and lurid confessions on the subject matter that we have, and it really is an extraordinary piece. But she talked about she met the devil on the road, and this interrupted journey seems to be part of the pattern of the dark man. We see it in the fairy lore, where people's journeys are interrupted and they're given a challenge of some description by the mysterious dark rider. And this case is similar. Her journey is interrupted at midnight when she was walking along the road, and she meets the devil, or Black John, as he would refer to by what would become her coven, and he invites her to come to the church at Aldern and be initiated into witchcraft. And she gives this extraordinarily vivid account of what the witch's Sabbath was like, where she was given a devil's mark, and the devil sucked blood from the mark and spat blood into his hand and sprinkled it over and re-baptized her, renamed her. And she would partake in the Sabbath, the Sabbatic rites, which included carnal knowledge with this being, and described the feeling of that experience as being ice cold inside of her. And he said all the young men, all the young women within the coven would lie with him and take great pleasure with him. He also taught them shapeshifting, and she recounted turning into a hare, turning into a deer, and the various different mischiefs that she would carry out at his behest, and been able to steal the strength from their neighbor's ale and what have you. And it's extraordinary. And one of the bits that kind of really jumped out at me from her account is it married up specifically with some ancient Irish folklore in terms of the specific detail of shape-shifting into a deer. And where I got this theme initially was from the Fenian cycle, which is this Irish a kind of a compilation of Fenian stories. If you can imagine kind of the Irish King Arthur and the Round Table, that's kind of what you're talking about with the Fenian stories. They center around Finn McCool, who would be the Arthurian figure, and then his collection of warrior poets. And they're like this elite unit that had all these adventures with the other world in these collection of stories. And this dates back to it's a collection of books called Uncolum na Shanarok, which means the colloquially of the ancients or of old men. And it's made up of three manuscripts, two from the 15th century, the Book of Lishmore and Laud 610, and a third from Killiney in County Dublin, dating from the 17th century. But the linguistic evidence dates the text far earlier, to be the 12th century. And we have to bear in mind that these manuscripts reflect a far older tradition, a far older oral tradition of storytelling. And within this story, there's a story around Fionn McCool hunting out in the woods near his homeland. And he comes across a doe, a female deer, that his dogs won't attack. And he brings this deer back into his fort. And that night, when he's lying in his chamber, the doe changes into a beautiful fairy woman who then enters his chambers and begs for his assistance in protection from a figure that she calls the Black Magician of the Men of God, or the Dark Man of the She. And the Dark Man of the She, or the Black Man of the She, is quite interesting, because the She is a word for fairy. And the Black Magician of the Men of God, or the Dark Druid of the Men of God, is a reference to the Tuatha De Danann, who are these the early kind of godlike beings and deities of Ireland. So she's transformed from a deer back into a fairy woman in the presence of Fionn. Fionn has to go away to fight some marauding Vikings as part of his duty. She waits for him to return, and she sees him coming up the road towards his fort and runs out to greet him. But as she does so, this figure transforms back into the Dark Man, touches her on the head with a hazel wand, transforms her into a deer, and she's never seen again. Now, Fionn spends 7 years searching through Ireland to try and find her again. He never does, but he does find a child. And the child recounts being in another land with a deer who looked after him, and a dark man who would sometimes come and be very tender to the deer and sometimes be very angry with the deer. And Fionn realizes that's his child, Usheen. So the interesting thing is, Usheen is half fairy, And he's called, and the name Usheen means little deer or little fawn. And it's Usheen who is the vehicle to carry the stories of the Fianna into the Christian age, as he's said to have gone to fairyland for 3 years with his fairy wife. And when he returns to Ireland, he accidentally touches the ground and is transformed into this ancient, ancient man. And Ireland, is the age of heroes is gone, and it's now the age of Christianity. And he ends up having these debates with St. Patrick, which are called the arguments, in the book of around two of the Danann of Warriors and Gods. What's extraordinary, he has these debates with St. Patrick, and this is all documented by, you know, written down by Irish monks. Now, it's a story. But what it tells us is the monks, the Christian monks, were actually quite favorable towards Usheen. Usheen does very well in these arguments. But it links this period of time, the age of mythology and heroes, with the Christian age. And Patrick, in this book, is debating with a half-fairy being. And that's the first instance of the fairy woman turned into a deer. There's another reference in the Fianna where a fairy woman called Lady Mal is turned into a deer to trick two members of the Fianna to come to the kingdom of the Lord of the Dead, who is called Don Dove. And it works. They are brought to the kingdom of the dead. Now, Don Dove is an interesting name because Dove means black. So we see this episode of someone being turned into a deer is done by somebody with the appellation the Lord of the Lord, the Dark Lord, the Don Dove, the Lord of the Dead. His name means black. And the magician that turned Saiva, the fairy woman, into a deer is on Fardov, the black man, the dark man, or the black magician of the men of God. So the appellation is consistent. What happens is consistent. There's another version of this story in the metrical Jinshaktas, which is a collection of mythological historic histories for the naming of Ireland and its towns, where a woman called Aiga is transformed into a deer and chased by evil spirits. Now, what's that got to do with Isabel Gowdy? Well, when she gives her account of how the dark man appears at the coven, she says, sometimes he appears as a man, sometimes he appears as a man with cloven feet, and sometimes he comes in the form of a ray. And a ray is an archaic Scottish name for a deer. So we have an inversion. And the researcher Joshua Cutchin, I'm sure you're familiar with his work.
Yeah, I think I may have interviewed him.
He describes inversion as representation when you're dealing with the fairy world. So we have a direct thematic link with the specificity of the transformation into a deer and this dark man. True names, true behavior, and his appearance as a composite being, and this interceptor trickster nature, and sex and sexual interest in human beings. It's the consistent pattern throughout.
That's absolutely fascinating. And, you know, it in many ways coincides with the close encounter experience and that lore and the lore that I have lived. I've lived with this, and I live with it today, right now. It's part of my life. The last time I had a big experience with it was with some friends in the woods in upstate New York 2 weekends ago.
Right.
Where it was a remarkable experience. And so this is real as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
When we talk about these things, we're not talking about some distant myth. We're talking about something that's real right now in the world.
Yeah.
How do you respond to that? Do you feel the same or not?
Oh, absolutely. It's world changing, you know. And we spoke earlier about being kind of the moderns being trapped in their head and kind of being trapped, you know, in an empirical worldview.
We're blind.
Yeah.
Blind. We've gone blind.
Totally. And this is where the impact of the experience that people have recounted to me, and I've had my own experience as well, but the impact of it, when you're confronting something that is utterly alien to you and you have no language for, there's no cultural references for it, everything you've ever learned says this shouldn't exist, yet you're face to face with it.
Yeah, I've been there.
Yes, you have, absolutely. You know, and this is, I'm preaching to the converted here, you know. But
still, it's great to hear you talking this way, because it's very affirming to close encounter witnesses like me, because we're not encountering aliens from another planet. Mm-hmm. We're encountering something much, much larger that mm-hmm. could easily include that.
But
it includes our own dead. And now I'm beginning to see that it includes this other level that is present in the Arab lore and in the Irish lore, and for that matter, it's present in England, in Scotland. The whole fairy faith of Northern Europe becomes involved, absolutely. And the jinn become involved. And there are, I'm sure, if you go to India, into the Hindu literature, you'll find them there too.
Yep.
They're here.
Yeah. I mean, the Indian equivalent
UFO either, did they?
But the Indian equivalent are there's a type of being called a Yakshini, which is associated with the three spirits. And the sadhus who want to work with a Yakshini will recite certain mantras like thousands, sometimes tens of thousands of times to engage a Yakshini and create a relationship with them. And here's another thing that these Yakshinis demonstrate. If one has a sexual or a romantic relationship with these spirits, the Yakshinis, they have intense jealousy that human can never have a relationship with another human being again. Now you have the exact same thing with fairies, and you have the exact same thing with jinn. So another cultural reference point.
You know, I had that actual experience in my life physically, because the lady who originally abducted me fell in love with me. There's no other way to describe it.
Sure.
And she started coming to the house all the time, and she was not comfortable with Anne at all. She would prefer to, she wanted to have our relationship in such a way that Anne kind of didn't exist in it.
Yeah.
But Anne did exist. And it was hard.
I can imagine.
Oh, it was very hard, because she kind of, in a way, it was also wonderful, because she really took care of the family. Mm-hmm. She became very, very involved with us. And like when my little boy brought up a child that she thought was not right for him, she drove that child out big time by, first of all, warning me by waking me up again and again in the night and showing me images of smoke coming out of the side of her mouth. The little boy had touched his tongue to a light socket when he was a child and had a scar. Right. And she apparently thought he was just the most fantastically irresponsible creature in the world, and my little boy should have nothing whatsoever to do with him.
Right.
Then the next morning, the little boy said, "Mr. Strieber, I would like to go home." And he described, she had these long, three long fingers and a thumb and hooked claws on them. They were very soft to touch you. But it didn't look very pleasant. They were quite scary looking.
Yeah, yeah.
And she was taking them around the door of the bedroom where the boy was sleeping, and tapping the nails on the door and scratching them up and down, and then the snake-like fingers would disappear, and she would wake him up again and again during the night. And he said, "Mr. Strieber, would you please take me home?" So I drove him home. And we never saw him again.
Mission accomplished.
But that's right. I mean, but what I'm saying here is, we're talking about, folks, something that's real and that's part of us and part of our lives and has been. How long do you think, Darren? Are they here before us?
I mean, this goes back to deep antiquity, deep antiquity. I think that there's one really fascinating thing that it's hard to get our heads around when we talk about families. You know, my view is that our idea of being an individual is probably, well, I theorize that's not how we're perceived by these beings, that actually we're perceived as the latest in the chain of our family, of our line, like we're pearls on a string. And we know that the other perceives time very, very differently to how we do.
Yes.
But there seems to be a familial interest that goes back through lines with some of these people who experience this.
Yes. In the close encounter world as well.
Yeah. Yeah. And we look at it in terms of, like, you know, a banshee, which literally means fairy woman. Why does a banshee mourn? Why does she mourn the passing of a family member? There has to be a reason for that, that there's this fairy has an interest in that family's welfare. But by the by, in terms of how far this goes back, there's a piece of cave art that I talk to in the book that's located in southwestern France, and it's called the Cave of the Trois Frères, and it's home to a piece of cave art which is entitled The Sorcerer, and it's dated to approximately 13,000 BC, and it's a composite being. It's the being has been interpreted as having antlers, bear paws, owl's eyes, and part human body. And it was discovered by a guy called Henry Bruhl, who's a French Catholic priest, archaeologist, anthropologist, and he made sketches of this that were published in the 1920s, and theorized that the figure was a shaman. And a lot of thinking in witchcraft identifies the sorcerer, and there's a few other of these pieces of art. One, another one called The Sorcerer in France as well, in a place in Dardogne as well, a very similar figure. And they appear as sometimes the dark, they are described and they are representations of what some would describe as the dark man in his composite being form, the therianthropic figure that is part human and part animal. And this form, I theorize, is to remind the human being that we're part of nature, that we're not above it, but we're on an equal footing with it, that we're part of nature. And this, the dark man is a representation of nature itself. You know, and you might say, well, why is that so terrifying? Shouldn't it be kind of like Gaia and all kind of like flowing, you know, green locks and, you know, flowers? And it's like, well, that's a misrepresentation of nature. You know, nature is tooth and fang. It's blood and claw.
Nature is ferocious.
Exactly.
And you know, speaking of ferociousness, folks, here's a really tortured segue to, we'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
We're talking to Darragh Mason. His book, Song of the Dark Man. His website, Darragh Mason, darraghmason.com. That's D-A-R-R-A-G-H Mason.com for those of you who are listening on podcasts. Well, you know what's going to happen is I'm going to how many podcasters sneeze on the air? Well, one that does, because my sneezes always catch up with me unexpectedly. I never have any warning. All right. You know, I'd like to move on here into the areas of psychopomps. And, you know, you talk about Shelley Porter.
Yes.
Yeah. Tell us a little bit about Shelley Porter, and I think that we'll move it that through there into the whole idea of what a psychopomp is. And because I think it's, you know, most of my listeners are close encounter witnesses,
right?
And a lot of them are anyway. And so this could be very important for us to understand.
So Shelley is a hereditary witch. She comes from a lineage of witches. And when she was a little girl, she used to see a dark man at the end of her garden. And she wrote about this being as she was a little girl. She wasn't afraid of the dark man at all. She thought it was a policeman when she was a little girl. But as she got older and started, I should add an important detail. Shelley was actually born dead. So she was born with an umbilical cord around her neck and had to be revived at birth. So that's quite an important note, because this would be in witchcraft circles be referred to as being born with a foot on both sides of the hedge representing the veil between life and death. And she's died several times. She's had a series of events in her life that have meant that she has come up against death firsthand, and in the book she gives an account of dying in hospital and the dark man appearing to her while she's in hospital and has left her body, and she remembers being in intense pain and her family members being there with her. And then the pain stopping and he appearing and asking her to go with him. And she's a very matter of fact person and asks quite straightforward to him, you know, am I dead? Do I have to go? To which he asked, you know, well, do you want to? And she said, no, I don't want to. I want to go back. But she talks about being walking through a desert with him and discussing what's going to happen. And the desert is an interesting motif because that gives us some kind of link to the jinn. Perhaps Shuli's based in the north of England. There's no deserts anywhere near her. But as it progresses, he takes her down into a place called the Dark Womb, which is this infinite water encased in a cave. And many people have been there and report being to the same place. And he immersed her in the water, to which she started to hear her heart beating again as she was healed. And she woke up again and the pain returned to her body. But she described the experience very vividly. She had a great recollection of it, and has a day-to-day relationship with him, with the dark man. He's present in her life, and she often hears him and sees him. I've been with Shuli where she's like, I can see him, he's over there by the hedgerow, which was quite wonderful and disconcerting at the same time. But the psychopomp is the guide from this world to the other, and that very much was playing out in the experience of Shuli's that I just described. And this is where you have figures like Hermes would represent the same thing. And it's a guide. It's a guide to navigate between this world and the other. And the Dark Man seems to have that jurisdiction. It's definitely something there with him. And I mentioned the figure of Don Dubh, the Lord of the Dead, in Irish mythology. And that would very much place this figure in that territory of psychopomp and Lord of the dead and the underworld. And I think an interesting kind of theme that crosses over there is within fairy lore, when people are taken to the fairy kingdom and whatever's happening, where they're at a kind of a fairy festivity, they will see the dead. They will recognize the dead from their life or their family. And I believe the same thing happens within abductions. People see dead relatives.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so it's an extraordinary crossover.
It's because this is the same thing. I mean, the fairy folk, the djinn, and the visitors are all the same thing, I think. We Flash Gordon them because it's the space age now.
Yeah.
But that's who we're... Yeah, let's talk about, speaking of that level of it. Gosh, there's so many directions I want to go in. I think that the trickster figure, the Dark Man is a trickster figure. You need to explain exactly what a trickster is, I think. And then I want to get into what you get into in chapter 5, which is cultural change and social upheaval, because we are in a period of that right now all over this world. And some of it's good and some of it's scary. So let's do that now.
So the trickster is a very, very powerful archetype that universally plays out in kind of whatever whatever pantheon of gods you think of. There's a trickster figure within the Greek pantheon. You know, Hermes is a trickster. Within the Norse, Loki is the trickster. And you have the rabbit and coyote in Native American tradition. So it's a global understanding that this force is there, and the trickster is one that is very challenging to deal with, because you never really know what motivations are behind it, or indeed how this is going to work out. You know, and this is why you have these kind of like myths around, you know, people trying to negotiate with the devil, and they kind of get what they ask for, but there's some sting in the tail, you know. And then to a kind of like a smaller level, a less kind of royal spirit level, where you have the whole thing of like trying to get the gold from a fairy. And you're given a bag of gold, but when you get home and you open it, it's just dead leaves, you know. So like those are kind of trickster qualities, you know. And like with Hermes, when Hermes is a baby, you know, he steals his older brother Apollo's calves, his cows, you know, and then makes up outrageous lies as to why it wasn't him, you know, which makes Zeus laugh so much he kind of forgives him and tells Apollo to kind of deal with it, you know. So his chaotic energy, or its chaotic energy to be more correct, is disrupts the apple cart, you know. It takes things in a different direction. It reminds human beings that we're really not in control, irrespective of our wealth, our health, our power, our position. Really, you know, we're not that in control. And
no, no, you know, we're not. Yeah. Not at all. Well, pre-Dreamlanders, speaking of being in control, I'm not in control of the fact that you won't subscribe to the site, but I wish you would. And even if you don't, I'm so glad you come to Dreamland and so glad you watch and listen and leave all your wonderful comments and those of you on the YouTube channel. I read them all and I certainly respond as much as I can. Darragh Mason, darraghmason.com, Song of the Dark Man. You can get it through unknowncountry.com. You can get it through Darragh's website, which is, it's extremely beautiful. We've not talked about Darragh's great talent as a photographer, but there is marvelous work there. It's a serious endeavor, so do take a look at that wonderful website. It's, speaking of magic, it is full of magic. And we'll see you again next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.